something. Good evening, everyone. Nice to see so many people. I know the school kids are thrilled to be here. This will be like better than the Super Bowl tonight, I guarantee it. So anyways, I'd like to welcome you all to the regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, February 6, 2017, at 7 p.m. Mr. Collier, you can call the roll.
Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsey?
Here.
Mr. Leidy?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Lethley?
Here.
Six members present.
Thank you, sir. And if we'll stand, we'll have tonight's invocation by Councilman Aaron Leidy.
All right. Dearly Father, we thank you for this opportunity for us to come together, Lord, and we ask that you bless the people of this city, the workers in this city, Lord, and we ask that you bless this council and help it guide us better your purpose. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, tonight we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance. Can you use the flag in the back, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll need actions on the regular scheduled council meeting for January 17, 2017.
Mr. Mayor, so moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Lindsey, a second by Mr. Reynolds.
Correct. Any discussion, council, on the minutes? When you're ready, Mr. Collier, no discussion.
The only thing I see was Mr. Lindsey. That's in the next one.
Sorry.
Mr. Lindsey.
Yes.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Minutes passed 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Now we'll move on. We'll need a motion for the minutes of the special meeting held on January 23rd, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
And I would add that Truth, his name is spelled two different ways in this, and I will correct that. Mr. Aaron Lighty's name is spelled Mr. Ryan Lightly.
Lightly?
I'll correct that. I got it right once and wrong the next time, so I'll correct that problem.
Very good.
Ready for your vote?
Yes. Sorry.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Special minutes passed 6-0.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
All right, moving on to communications tonight. We have a proclamation from our Minim Award for New Pyle Elementary and Principal Randenberg. So I would ask Ms. Randenberg, that's in the very back, to please come up here and join me.
Join you there.
What's that?
Way up there.
Right up here, please.
Right here.
When you're done, you can sit in that empty seat.
Yeah, right here.
Yeah, you can sit right there and just retire from the school.
Right.
So, we'll read this proclamation. It's for Westlake Elementary and its staff and Ms. Randall. New Pyle Elementary.
Old habits.
All right. This proclamation to honor and recognize the staff of New Pyle Elementary School. I'm receiving the 2016 Ohio State Board of Education's 2016 Momentum Award. Whereas the New Carlisle Elementary School educates, inspires, and supports 465 students in grades 4th and 5th from the Tecumseh Local School District. And whereas 55 diverse staff members ensure these students reach their fullest potential by addressing each student's individual needs. And whereas the motto, Learning for All, Whatever It Takes, is a cornerstone anthem for the Tecumseh Local School District that focuses on academics, supportive environment, and teaching 21st century skill sets. And whereas in 2016, the Ohio State Board of Education has recognized the New Carlisle Elementary School with a Momentum Award, and whereas the Momentum Award recognizes schools that have received A's on every value added subgroup measure on the 2016 Ohio School Report Card. And whereas the students at New Carlisle Elementary made greater than expected progress in reading and mathematics. And whereas the Momentum Award is unique in that only a handful of schools across the great state are honored, thus providing the entire school, the entire New Carlisle Elementary staff are dedicated in educating and nurturing our youngest populations and future community leaders. And whereas we should all take a moment and thank those who educate and inspire our children to reach their fullest potentials. And whereas the Office of the Mayor will continue to support Principal Randenberg and the Tecumseh Local School District because we are all proud to be part of something that is bigger than each of us, the Tecumseh Arrows. Mm-hmm. Now therefore, I, Mike Lowry, do hereby honor and recognize the entire staff of the New Carlisle Elementary School for being awarded the 2016 Momentum Award by the Ohio State Board of Education, and I call this observant to the attention of all of our citizens. And this is for you.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for recognizing us at New Carlisle Elementary. I certainly don't want to take this myself, so this is for all of New Carlisle Elementary. That, again, we work with our kids every day, and that's everyone from the bus drivers to the cafeteria to all the staff. And I'll take them back and share this with them tomorrow.
Good job. Congratulations.
So, thank you very much.
All right, moving on tonight in communications, Ethan Harris, Clark County Community Development, Fair Housing Presentation for Public Officials. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Do all the council members have copies of the slides? Great.
Yes, sir.
Normally they're in a presentation form, but hopefully the paper slides will work. My name is Ethan Harris. I coordinate the grants and the land bank for the county. Annette Ulrey, she's the fair housing coordinator. She's actually who you would want to contact if you had any fair housing issues. I'm going to speak in regards to what fair housing is for the county and why it is that we provide this service. Our department, the Clark County Community Economic Development Department, does building, planning, zoning, administers the land bank, and administers the community development grants for the county. If you're wondering what it is to do or why we do. Our current grants that we are operating right now are the Community Development Block Grant, and that's what brings me here today. New Carlisle is sharing in a very large portion of that grant this year, and I'll talk a little bit about that also. And our other grant is the Neighborhood Improvement Program. That's our largest grant that we're operating right now. That's a little over $2 million, so that keeps us pretty busy. The CDBG grant, currently the Prentice Drive is being reconstructed. It will be going through the paperwork process currently. It was done in four phases. First two phases have already been completed, if you guys know that. Phase three was applied through the allocation, and phase four was a competitive grant. Howie and Brandy were very helpful in getting that through. That's the county's first competitive grant that we've won, so it's pretty exciting. It's great to have it done here in New Carlisle. New Carlisle contributed $91,000 to that, and that was instrumental in that that competitive grant being accepted. So. Great work for everyone here in this room. Fair housing, it's concerned with tenant-landlord discrimination and issues. That takes on two forms. You have the discrimination side of it, and then you have the tenant-landlord issues. this happens on a daily basis in Clark County. New Carlisle isn't an exception to that. We cannot provide legal advice, however, we as the county have Annette who takes phone calls and she kind of disseminates where those people should go from her. Usually it's to a legal aid counsel, but we will provide information. And that information I want to get to you. My thought is that if someone has a fair housing issue, that they might contact their most local public representative, and that being you. But I want the council to have the information necessary to get them to us and to be just educated on what you should do when you encounter that. Because if you haven't already, I imagine that you will at some point in time in your post as a council member. So the information, the thing that is most important for a tenant is to have a signed contract. It's pretty common actually for someone to get into a relationship where they're renting an apartment or a house, but they don't have any type of legal documentation of that. In that scenario, you can be kicked out of your housing at any point in time. So you need to have that document in writing. You also need to pay your rent on time. If you are one day late, you have basically forfeited all your rights to your landlord. So the first thing, a typical phone call goes, my heater's not working and my landlord won't fix it. Responses, have you paid your rent? Not in 3 months. Okay, at that point in time, you have no legal course of action because you haven't paid your rent. And all of the rights go to the landlord at that point. However, if you've paid your rent, then you have some course of action to take against them. You can place your rent in what's called escrow. So you still have to pay your rent, but you pay your rent to the court. And the court holds the funding or the rent until your landlord fixes the problem, and then the court will pay the landlord what he's due. That is the only course of action that a tenant has against a landlord. Any questions in regards to that? Okay, great. Discrimination, so that's the other issue. Someone cannot rent to you on the basis of they're not a, how should I say this appropriately? So if I want to rent a property from someone, I cannot be denied on the basis of race, color, national origin, religion, sex, family status, or a handicap. There's several organizations available to help against this type of discrimination. And you would just want to get in contact with our office, and we would take the steps appropriate to correct that action being taken place in the county. All right, so one other thing that we have to do under CDBG is an analysis of housing in the county every 5 years. It's called the analysis of impediments. We conducted that last year, and there were 8 impediments found in the county to fair housing. For the past 40 years, it's been the federal government's desire to disperse dense, low-income housing out of urban areas. They feel the federal government believes that is a good way to combat low-income housing and discrimination that takes place. In the county, in Springfield, there's 30% of Springfield's population is African American. In the county, only 1.5, I'm not even in the county, outside the city of Springfield, only 1.5% of the population is of any origin other than Caucasian. The federal government believes that if we were, that we need to open avenues into the rural areas for low-income populations. There's, under the new administration, that's changing. There is legislation to change that. However, we still have to work towards these impediments and improving those until that perception changes of needing to disperse. What we found in our surveys is that low-income populations and populations that are discriminated against tend to want to live in urban areas because that's where their family is, that's where their services are. So the impediments that we found, the first impediment is advertisement. In this county, almost all the advertisement is via the internet. That is an impediment because low-income families might not have the internet. Racial segregation, like I just described, only 1.5% of people of color live in the county. Racial steering, it is illegal. Say I go to buy a house and from a realtor and I ask them, I say to them, I don't want to live near someone of those populations based on race, color, national origin, religion. That realtor would be breaking the law if he steered me in a direction away from any of those protected classes. And in a survey that we did of realtors, they felt that that did take place in our county, and we are taking actions to correct that currently. There's a lack of public housing, and that there's twofold to that. There's a lack of public housing. The Metropolitan Housing believes that you can't have public housing outside those city hubs, such as Springfield, because there's not transportation to New Carlisle, South Charleston, those areas. So we first have to get public transportation out of the city, and then we can increase public housing, say in New Carlisle, South Charleston, and the more rural areas. Unemployment continues to be a barrier to fair housing, and career services, again, are centralized in the city of Springfield, and that can't be opened up again until we have public transportation outside of the city of Springfield. That is fair housing in a nutshell and what the county provides in terms of fair housing. Is there any questions?
Council, any questions?
We do have pamphlets at the New Carlisle Administration Building, so there's those resources are provided there. And we provide a fair housing training similar to this, but for residents at the New Carlisle Library on a quarterly basis.
Mr. Briggs, did you have anyone to add on this one? No? Okay. Mr. Harris, we appreciate it, and thank you for coming out tonight.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
All right, moving on into communications, we've got something added on that wasn't on to the regular meeting agenda. Before I hand this over to you, Mr. Lethley, I wanted to give Chief Trusty a minute, since we've got such a big crowd, and you'll understand why I'm asking this here in a minute. If you could explain the Luca stool with everyone here tonight, explain what it is and why it's important and where we're at in funding.
The Luca stool is an automatic CPR device that allows our crews to perform CPR on a patient without the crew doing it themselves. It's an apparatus that straps onto the chest of the patient, but plungers load onto the patient and turns on, and it does perfect CPR by the American Heart standards continuously. We can move the patient while the machine's working. We don't have to stop. We don't have to stop CPR at any time. It can continue to do the CPR while we're moving the patient. It's putting another person on the rig with the crews. It frees up the other paramedics and EMTs to go ahead and start their IV lines, get the patient intubated, get a tube down, start a drug rotation, put them on a monitor to see if we're able to shock them for a shockable rhythm. The statistics right now show a marked improvement in bringing getting a resuscitation back on scene from a 20% to a 60%. And that's a large margin when it comes to CPR. It's getting that patient back, given the viability for that patient to get to maintain that life. If we can get them back on the scene, get that heart rate back, get their heart beating again, It's a lot. It means a lot to that patient. It gives their survivability rate tremendous increase. The tool right now runs right around $14,000 to buy for one. We've been doing fundraising and also secured a $3,200 grant from the state for EMS. Right now, we're right about $7,000, in between $6,000 and $7,000 in between our fundraising and also this year with the Heritage of Flight committee. They were so graciously to donate half of the portion of the 50-50 drawing to us, and that was a big boost for it also. Not very many departments in the area or in the county have them. The closest one to us right now is Elizabeth Township, which is to get into the city is a 15 to 20 minute ride. So having one in the city is a would be a tremendous, tremendous help for every citizen in the city. If it saves one life, it paid for itself. We also, as the fire division, we also are contracted to Elizabeth Township to provide manpower for that station. Their trustees bought one this year within 24 hours of the piece of equipment being put in service. It was used on a full arrest. That's how important it is for us.
Thank you, Chief. I appreciate that. Now I will hand it over to Mr. Lethley.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As Chief Trustee said, there's been a lot of discussion about the fundraising efforts of the fire department for the purchase of the Lucas tool. And we actually, last meeting, found out that some funds that we were hoping to get in from the county are not coming our way, so kind of a little disappointed about that. So I went to my people at Security Bank and I told them about it, and actually I just asked for an outright donation and hoping, you know, ask for the sky and hope for something, and ended up getting something a little bit better. So I'm pleased to announce that Security National Bank would like to support the New Carlisle Fire Department by offering to match all donations up to a total of $3,500 collected within a 90-day period for the purchase of a Lucas tool. We hope this donation match will offer an updated advertising opportunity for the fundraising campaign, generate renewed enthusiasm for the fundraiser, encourage community members and businesses to make donations toward the effort, and of course get them to their fundraising goal so that the fire department can purchase the Lucas tool. So basically, if we can get in the next 90 days $3,500 donated, Security Bank will donate $3,500 match. We'll have $7,000 and we'll be able to pay purchase that tool. Now, just like in some of the late night advertisements, the way for more. In an effort to kickstart the campaign, my wife and I is going to donate $500. And then I talked to the good folks at New Carlisle Federal, and they're going to make a donation of $500. So with that $1,000 and a match of $1,000, we're already $2,000 towards that goal. I encourage all businesses to and community members to make any donations. Chief will get together somehow, whether we end up setting up an account at the bank, have people just come in and donate at the department, that's fine, but we'll get together on that and we're to make this thing happen.
Thank you, sir.
One last thing is, nothing's going to make me more happier than to have my boss write a check for $3,500.
That's awesome.
Awesome.
That is awesome.
On behalf of myself and the division, thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, on behalf of Security National Bank, we want to thank the fire department and the MS people. It's very critical to this community.
Absolutely.
Great news. Thank you, Mr. Lethley.
Thank you, Mr.
Make sure you pass on the entire city's council and staff a big thank you.
I will.
All right.
Moving on.
We're moving on, sir.
We are.
Move on to the city manager's report.
Awesome. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Members of council, members of public, I'd like to share with you the city manager's report. Let me get to the page here real quick. Under action items, we've got the Bell Manor. We did have a meeting on the 30th of January with our legal department. Through that meeting, we have determined that I will be recommending to City Council to have a completely new phase one environmental study and an asbestos study done by CTL Engineering. The cost of phase one for the environmental is $2,000. and that's just for, yep, 2,000 for the phase one, excuse me. The asbestos study, if we only get the asbestos study and leave out the phase one, would be $4,500. Both tests together would be 6,000. There already is a phase one engineering study on file for that. However, it's from about 3 years ago. The standard shelf life of those is 180 days. They can come out and do what they call a supplement to that report. That supplement is about $1,500. So it's about 75% of the cost of the new one. So that being said, I will be putting forth for a brand new study to be done for additional $500. I'm gonna stick with CTL Engineering because they're the company who did it last time. So the time frame for them to complete it and then get it back in our hands has been drastically reduced. So in the coming council meetings, we'll have a resolution or ordinance in place for council to approve that study. I do think that is a crucial component to the Bellminer donation. We need to make sure that we have crossed every T and dotted every I before we say yes to that building. The asbestos study will tell us where it's at, how to remove it, if we need to remove it, and stuff like that. I don't think there's any asbestos that we would have to take control of right away. Any kind of interior remodeling that they have done, they would have to address the asbestos situation at the time. So again, I think it's best if we go out and get these studies done, especially the asbestos study, because at some point in time, we will be doing some renovations in the interior to allow for council chambers in there. Moving on down and from under informational items, the City of New Carlisle now has an official Facebook page. Please take a minute to find that and like it. If there are a few different City of New Carlisle pages out there, ours has our official city seal and a picture of the downtown on the actual main page picture. I've got a lot of good response to that, a lot of good information going directly to our citizens and business owners. So take advantage, look at that, and like it on Facebook. Moving on down, new police cruiser process has begun. The vehicle is not in stock, so we will have to order that new vehicle. The expected pickup date is around April or May, but we will still have to install light bars and the sheriff vials once we get everything in stock. So that could add actually a few more weeks onto it before it's actually in service. I think last time around, some council members wanted us to inquire about dash cams. So we did get quotes on those. They're about $5,000 a piece. So if we end up getting them, we'd get two. We'd get one for the new cruiser and one for the cruiser that we got last year for Deputy Allen. And moving on down the city board, I do need a motion to approve the following, each with their own motion. You want to go ahead and read those, or let me read them? Because I'm going to read them twice.
I can go ahead and do it because I've just tallied it on my sheet. I'm really well.
Okay, gotcha. And just so everyone in the audience knows, these are for our boards that we have in the city. All right, our planning board, our tax review board, our board of zoning appeals. So that's what they're going to be pointing out. A citizen can choose to be on the board. These are just all reappointments, so they've already been on the boards before. Their term just expired, so what they're doing is just reappointing them for another 2 years or 1 year, 3 years, or however long that given board position can last.
You ready? Need a motion to appoint Mayor Lowry and John Krabacher to the Volunteer Firefighters Dependent Fund Board.
So moved.
Second.
Had a motion by Mr. Leslie. Second, Mr. Reynolds. Any discussion? Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Abstain.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0-1. Need a motion to appoint Paul Mola Jr. and Sue Thompson to the Tax Board of Review.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
So moved to appoint these two individuals.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Lindsay, second by Mr. Reynolds. Mm-hmm. Any discussion?
Sir?
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0. Need a motion to appoint Patricia McFarland to the Planning Board.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
Make the motion to appoint Patricia McFarland to the Planning Board.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Lindsey, second by Mr. Reynolds. The vote, Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0. Need a motion to appoint Janet Addio to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Mr. Mayor, I was looking at Aaron. Come on, Aaron.
Oh, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion.
Mr. Lyons, two people.
Thank you.
You threw me off there. All right.
He's on the board. There he is.
Thank you.
Second by Mr.
Lethley, not me this time.
You guys are clever. You really threw me off there. Okay. Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0. That takes care of it.
Awesome. And we do have a few vacancies to which I will post an ad in the New Carlisle News. I'll also post it on the New Carlisle Facebook page that we do have openings. We have one vacancy for the Tax Review Board. And what that does is basically says, all right, I want to get a penalty knocked off of my past due taxes. Our tax administrator will call a meeting. That's a three-person board. You guys say yay or nay, depending on the circumstance. We have one vacancy in the Board of Zoning Appeals. What the Board of Zoning Appeals does is say, you want to build a house, and you want a 16-foot fence in your backyard. Well, the highest you can go in the city is 8 feet. So you want a variance from our zoning code. So you would file, you would fill out an application, you would pay a fee, you would go sit in front of the BZA, they would hear your case. Again, they would say yes or no to your 16-foot fence, which would probably be no, more than likely. Just putting it out there. We also have three vacancies on our Human Rights Board. And what that does, that's more of a discrimination-based board. If you feel as though you are being discriminated in this town, whether it be housing, job, personally, you would come fill out a complaint with the city. The board gets together. They determine if there's been any violation of discrimination laws. If so, they will probably at that point in time get with a police officer. I don't know what the next steps are. Honestly, that board has probably never met. So it's one of those ones that are there. We need to have it there, but it's just one of those things that just they don't really meet all that often. We also have a couple vacancies on our Civil Service Commission. How would you explain the Civil Service Commission? That would just be like, Carol, aren't you on the Civil Service Commission? You have never met either.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's just another board that never meets. But again, if you want to be on it, we have two vacancies for that as well, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds?
With any of these boards that are open, like, is there like a certain minimum age requirement for any young politicos in the audience who want to get involved?
Definitely got to be 18 or older.
18 or older?
Yeah.
All right. Probably registered elector also?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
How many people is on these boards? Is it three, two,
five? It all depends on which board. Every board has a different amount.
Okay, the tax board.
Review board has three. The planning board and the Board of Zoning Appeals has five each. Civil Service Commission has three. Human Rights has five. The Human Rights have default members as myself and the mayor.
Anything else, Mr. George? No. Yeah, the Board of Zoning Appeals, I mean, if anyone's in, that's actually kind of an interesting board. You meet, a few times a year, maybe more. But
yeah,
that gets you involved actually with a lot of stuff in the city. So if anyone has any free time, that's kind of a neat board to learn about.
Out of all the boards, we have our planning board meet the most, and then our Board of Zoning Appeals. The planning board is a really fun one. Like when they put the new CVS in, they'll get the site plan and say, yeah, we want a few trees here, or we want a white vinyl fence here. You know, that's the fun stuff. The Board of Zoning Appeals, it's always fun too, but you always got to tell somebody no if they want to do a project that doesn't meet our code or has any safety issues. So, always a great way to get involved in your community. Absolutely.
Sure.
Yep. And moving on, our final thing on the city manager report is we've got a big project on the horizon. It's called the Scarf Power Water Tower Project. I asked our service director, Mr. Kitko, to give me a little background information on that project. We have budget work sessions starting this Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. We will be discussing the in-depth cost at that point in time. But a little history on this is our Scoff water tower is in a major repair mode. It needs to be repainted. The interior and exterior also need to be cleaned. With that being said, this project has been put off by the city for a very, very, very long time. So it's something that Mr. Kickard brought to me. I told him to look into it, and this is where we're at now. Basically, what they would do is the exterior of the Scarf Tower is lead, and it's very, very close to having its life expectancy to where we can just basically repaint it for a fraction of the cost. If we let it go any longer, that is going to have to be a completely new paint job on the outside, which is going to increase our total project cost by about 30%. But basically, what we need to do with the Scarf Tower is clean the inside from the outside. We need to put a motor in there that helps with water turnover, and we also need to put plant pumps and controls in so that particular water tower can access pumps and stuff like that at our water plant. So again, this has been on the drawing board for a long time. Back in 2006, the city council approved a new water plant. We've been paying on that loan since 2006 at $217,000 a year. Our water plant is big. Well, big enough for us. We could probably use about a couple hundred thousand more houses to be able to get it to its full capacity. And I say a couple hundred thousand, obviously that's not the number that it would take, it's very less. But at the end of the day, this is something that we've had to do for the longest time. I think this particular enterprise fund has had low balances due to the fact of the water plant loan that we've been paying on for the past 20 years. But moving forward, we will have finalized numbers at our budget work session on Wednesday. We have the gentleman coming this Wednesday too, correct? So any particular questions of that, we'd be happy to entertain them at this point in time. But like I said, we'll discuss more in detail starting Wednesday. I just wanted to give council a little bit of a background of what's going on with that water tower.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Questions, council?
I have a suggestion, and it has nothing to do with the water tower, but it does have to do with your report.
What's that?
Okay. Bellman, $6,000 for both tests?
Yeah.
I suggest you go to the owners and ask them to pay for the test.
Why would they do that?
Why wouldn't they?
I'll try. I mean, they're under no obligation to pay for that.
No, course. They're under no obligation. Absolutely not.
Okay, sure. I will definitely try for you, Mr. Lowry. Absolutely.
Thank you. Mr. Reynolds.
Do you have access to that report, the old study that they had done about 3 years ago?
Yes, I do.
Would that be able to provide it to council so that we could read over it? And it's an older study, but I would prefer to know what we're
doing. Did I not send it out to you guys when I first got that?
No. I know. Now again, my email's not been working on it for quite some time.
Yeah, I might have already sent that to you. I would definitely double check.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Lindsay.
Will that report go to all council members?
The what report? The ones he's requesting or the
new
one? Sure.
Thank you.
Any other questions from council? Mr. Burge, thank you very much for the report.
No problem. Thank you.
All right, and we will be moving on to comments from the members of the public. So if anyone in the audience has any questions, comments, concerns, this is your time to step up to the podium. You'll need to give us your name and address and say what you need to say. So, any takers?
Nope.
All right. Thank you very much. And moving on, committee reports, none tonight. And we have one resolution on for tonight. Mr. Collier.
Resolution 17-02R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution adopting rules of council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lynn.
I move we accept resolution 17-02R.
Second.
My bad.
I'm just used to going second.
I got Lindsay and I have Mr. Reynolds for the second. Any discussion?
Council? No, sir. When you're ready.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to ordinances, none tonight. We'll drop down to other business. When you're ready, Mr. Coy.
Yes, sir. Budget work sessions. There'll be budget work sessions for council on Wednesday, February the 8th, and Thursday, February the 16th. Both meetings will begin at 6:30 p.m. They are open to the public, and they'll be held here at Smith Park Shelter House, correct?
Sure.
All right. Because there was a question of whether or not this was available.
It's open. Somebody called and scheduled the, so I mean, it's definitely reserved.
Okay. Very good. Town hall meeting will be Monday, March 6th, immediately following the city council meeting. The normal meeting will start at 6:30 p.m., and that usually is a short meeting, then we'll go into the town hall meeting. And that is also open to the public. City offices will be closed on Monday, February the 20th, for President's Day. And I wanted to add that Crime Watch meetings will start up again on March the 8th, which is a Wednesday. They'll start at 6:30 p.m. and they'll be here at Smith Park Shelter House. And Mayor, I would add, if Council Craig would probably do something or do some motion to accuse Mr. Craybaugh.
Let's accuse him. Mr. Reynolds was one step in front of him. Mr. Reynolds.
I move that we accept Mr. Craybacher's formless absence. There we go, into a coherent sentence.
Second.
I'll list 117, 123 in today.
Yep, that sounds good to me.
Yes. Motion by Mr. Reynolds.
That's what he said.
In a roundabout way.
He didn't get based, did he?
Yeah, you didn't get it?
No. I'm not that deaf.
He's quick.
He's not that quick. Second. Was that you, Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
All right. You can find the charger. Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Motion approved 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Executive session none tonight, and just follow students. If you guys have cards that get signed for class, just see Mr. Reynolds. I'll take care of all of
us. Just form a line right here.
This might be E after a while.
All right.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Mayor.